So we have seen that T is not self-adjoint, but of course it could be essentially self-adjoint. So maybe if we take the closure of it, then we get a self-adjoint operator. And of course we know that our operator is closable because it is symmetric. So let us think first maybe about this. So we know that T is closable just because it's symmetric. So first of all, one should think about, is it actually closed? But it is not. Why not? How do we see this? But it is not closed. We can get this because, I mean, we know if we have an operator, a closable operator, we can get its closure by just taking the adjoint of the adjoint. This always gives the closure of our operator. So let us just do this in our case because we have the adjoint. And now taking the adjoint of the adjoint is more or less the same calculation. So this is something which we can also do quite easily. So we get its closure as, the closure I usually denote by T bar, but I can get this as the adjoint of the adjoint. And if I do this, I do more or less the same calculations as before. We see that I have to go back again, and because I have no boundary conditions for the T star, I need the boundary conditions to get rid of these boundary terms in the partial integration, which means I really need the conditions on the boundary conditions, but what I don't need is that my function is continuously differentiable. So I just stay within the domain of all of absolutely continuous functions. So if you do the calculation, more or less, it's the same ideas as before, we get that the domain of the closure of T, or maybe better, the domain of this operator, the adjoint of the adjoint, is given by L2 functions, which are absolutely continuous, for which the derivative is in L2, but now we need boundary conditions. Because for T star, if we have no boundary conditions, we need the other elements, the elements in the star of the star. We need those guys to satisfy the boundary conditions so that the boundary terms in the partial integration go away. So here we need that F0 is equal to 0 and also F1 is equal to 0. And of course the effect of T bar, the closure, is as before, just taking the derivative. Okay, so you see, I mean, the closure really doesn't get us, the boundary conditions survive, the closure doesn't do anything with the boundary conditions, but it somehow improves or weakens the condition on a function so that we still can be sure that we can take the derivative. So I mean, we were very conservative in the beginning. We took functions which have a lot of nice properties where we really were sure that we can take the derivative and we can work with them. But this was a too strong condition, and this can be weakened, and taking the closure does exactly this. So I mean, taking the closure moves us really to the class of functions where we still can take the derivative. But it does not affect the boundary conditions. And actually the problem with the self-adjointness lies in the boundary conditions. So the closure doesn't really help us in this. Okay, so let me see what have we here. And so this means, in particular, so I mean this here has a few meanings now. First of all, this tells us that the operator, the adjoint of T, is not symmetric anymore. Why not? Because if we take the adjoint, we are getting something which has a smaller domain. The adjoint is this here without the boundary conditions, and if I take the adjoint of this, I get the boundary conditions, which means I'm making the domain smaller. But for a symmetric operator, the domain should be bigger, should become bigger. So in particular, from this here, we see that the adjoint is not symmetric anymore. So the adjoint is, The adjoint is an extension of our original operator, but we have extended it too far. We are losing the symmetry condition. Because the T double star is a subset of the T star, but it's not the same. Also, because here we have no boundary conditions, but here we have the boundary conditions. So this is actually smaller. Symmetric, it should be the other way around. But from this, of course, we also see the condition that the T is not essentially self-adjoint. The T is not essentially self-adjoint, which is the same as the closure of T is self-adjoint. So from this, we also see going over to the closure of T doesn't help us to get a self-adjoint operator. Not yet. We have to do something more. Namely what we have here, let me write it down again. So the closure of T, this is the adjoint of the adjoint. Just write down this here again. This is a subset, but not equal to the adjoint. The adjoint is an extension of this operator, but the adjoint of an operator and the adjoint of the closure of the operator are the same. So for the closure of my operator T, I see that the closure, of course, is contained here. So the closure is still a symmetric operator. Going over to the closure, I'm not losing the symmetry condition, but I'm not gaining the self-adjointness condition because I still have here different. So this means this guy here, the closure, is not self-adjoint, and this means the original operator T is not essentially self-adjoint. So thus, the closure of T is not self-adjoint, and this means that T is not essentially self-adjoint. So this means we started from our operator T. This operator is symmetric. Then we take the closure, and this closure improves some things, namely it makes the domain of the functions bigger, as big as possible for dealing with differentiability, but it doesn't really move us to a self-adjoint operator. We still have now to think, are there actually self-adjoint extensions of this operator? If we go to the adjoint, this is a too big extension because there we use the symmetry condition. And so maybe in order to see whether there actually could be self-adjoint extensions, maybe we should have a look on the defect indices because they, as I told you, contain this information. So maybe that's the next thing which we should consider here. So what are the defect indices of our operator T? Of the closure, that's the same. And so what is it? I mean, these defect indices, they have two descriptions. So either they are the dimension of the kernel of something, or they are the dimension of the orthogonal range of something. One goes with T, the other goes with T star, and maybe calculating the kernel is maybe a more direct calculation because it's an eigenvalue equation, but this goes with T star. But we have here T star, so this is something which we can do here quite nicely. So let us take this in the one of the indices, M, in the form as a dimension of the kernel of T star minus I. So this dimension. If this dimension is zero, and the other dimension is zero, then it's a self-adjoint operator. So we already have seen it's not self-adjoint or essentially self-adjoint. So this means one of the dimensions surely cannot be equal to zero. But let us see what this means. So we take the kernel of this operator. This means we are looking on functions for which the application of T star minus I times the identity is equal to zero, or which is just the eigenvalue equation that T star applied to F is I times F. That's what elements in this kernel are. So how many elements are there? Of course, the zero function is always a solution of this. T star of F, what is this? This is I times the derivative of F. And now you see what we have here is just, the I goes away. We just have the equation that the derivative of F is equal to F. And of course, there are non-trivial solutions to this, namely just the exponential functions. So this means here that F of T is just a constant times e to the t. So essentially, this space here is one-dimensional. So that's the only
solutions to this equation.
So this dimension is one-dimensional, so this means m is equal to 1, because the adjoint has those guys here as a solution. But you see, we really have to go to the adjoint. The original operator t, because of the boundary conditions, this e to the t are not in the domain of t, because, yeah, you see, you don't find e functions which are 0 at 1, at 0 and 1. Okay. But for t star, we don't have any boundary conditions, so this is an eigenfunction of t star. And so you see why we have to look on t star and not on t to decide about the defect indices. Good, and in the same way, of course, also if I take here t star plus I, then I will get e to the minus t as a solution. So also n equal n, the other dimension, defect index is also 1. And so what we have here is the pair of defect indices is 1, 1. And what I told you is that if the two defect indices are equal, then I can extend my operator to a self-adjoint operator. And so this means my operator is not self-adjoint, or not essentially self-adjoint, but I should be able to extend it, to find an extension which is self-adjoint. Yeah, and so the question is what? So there are self-adjoint extensions, but how do we find them, or how do we understand what they should be? And of course, the point is we should make the domain of my operator bigger, but not too big. And of course, the only thing we can play with are the boundary conditions. They are important. So in a sense, I have here I have two strong boundary conditions. And if I go to the adjoint, I have two weak, namely no boundary conditions at all anymore. So what I should find are boundary conditions which are somewhere in the middle, such that the boundary conditions for T imply the same kind of boundary conditions for the adjoint. So let us try to understand this. So what are now self-adjoint extensions? Let me call it S. This is extension. So just to, if I now write down the equation, this should be for an extension, and the problem is with the boundary conditions. And so why this? Let us look at it again. So what we want is, of course, we want to bring S from one side in the inner product to the other. This means we have to do partial integration, and the partial integration works, of course, nicely if our functions are differentiable, what they always are, but we have to see that the boundary conditions go away. So we have to ask for the right boundary conditions on our functions such that the conditions go away. So what we want is that fsg is the same as fsfg. So the s from here should go to the other side, but for big classes of functions as possible. So what is this? So this is I times f bar g prime. So s is now the derivative, or I times the derivative. And this should be the same as on the other side. So here I have I times f prime. The I comes on this side, it comes out as a minus guy, minus. So you see why we put the I, because in the partial integration, I get also minus sign. And this should be absorbed, essentially, by this I. Because the I on this side it comes out as an I, on this side it comes out as a minus I. Good, so here I get minus I, and then I have here the derivative of f prime times g, and I want to change this into this side by doing partial integration, so I can do this. I move the derivative to this side, then the sign here changes, so I have here I f bar g prime. That's exactly what I want, but partial integration also gives me boundary terms, which are here minus I, and then I have f times g at 0 and at 1. So I have here f bar of 1, g of 1 minus f bar of 0, g of 0. And now what I want and what I need is that actually this combination here has always, for all my calculations, has to be equal to 0. So this means I need conditions on f and g which ensure that this combination here is equal to 0. And in my definition of my operator, I have here put very strong conditions on F, let's say, namely that this guy is 0, this guy is 0, and then I don't need anything on the G. So this means I have asked two strong conditions on the functions, so that for the functions in the domain of the adjoint, I don't need any conditions at all, which means it's not the same. But if I want the self-adjoint operator, F and G should be on the same level. So this means I should ask here for conditions on F, which enforce the same conditions for G, so that this whole thing here is equal to 0. So, and actually there are conditions which are somehow between this strong condition and no condition at all. So if I ask for this, then I enforce no condition at all. If I ask for no condition at all, then I enforce this. So now I should find something which essentially enforces itself. It's quite easy to see is that actually, I mean, you should not ask that f of 0 and f of 1 are equal to 0 at the same time, but it's enough to have some relation between f of 1 and f of 0. So in a sense, if I ask f of 0 is 0 and f of 1 is equal to 0, this means I don't need no conditions for G. Because if this is 0 and this is 0, this guy here is always 0 without any requirement on G. But actually I can ask for a weaker condition for F, namely that F of 0, F of 1 is a multiple of F of 0. And then if I ask this for F, then to have this here always equal to 0, then I need the same condition for G. And I need special condition on the alpha here. So namely here, then I have the same condition for G, namely that this is alpha times G of 0. And I need the same alpha here for the same alpha. And actually this alpha must be on a unit circle. So it must be a complex number of modulus 1. So alpha should be in the, let's say, torus, so the complex numbers, where the absolute value is equal to 1. Because then you see, if I look on F1, complex conjugate times G1 minus F0, complex conjugate G0, then this becomes 0, because F1 is alpha times of F0, so this is F0 bar, and the alpha, because I take the bar, I get here the alpha bar. And the same here, the G is, it has the same condition, so it also has alpha times G of 0, and so you see I get here this guy times this guy, and I get the alpha bar times alpha, so I get the square of the absolute value of alpha. So if I require that the absolute square of alpha, that the square of the absolute value of alpha is equal to 1, this guy here goes away. So you see that this is somehow a condition, and you can also think a little bit to see that if you ask this condition for the F, then the same condition is exactly what you need for the G, to get here always 0. So this means we should take this here as a boundary condition. This is a weaker boundary condition than the one which we had here, because, I mean, this here, if I have this, then of course I also have this property for any alpha. So if I only ask this, I ask less than I'm asking here. But of course I'm asking more than having no condition. So I get something which is sitting between T and T star. So I get this for each alpha. So I have now different possibilities for making the boundary conditions, and those are different boundary conditions, which are not compatible with each other. So I can take for alpha, I can take alpha equal to 1, I can take alpha equal to minus 1, and those are two different conditions, which means I'm getting two different operators, which I cannot compare to each other. So for each alpha in the torus, I define now an operator, which I call T alpha. Okay, maybe T is not good here for the torus also, because T was our operator. So let's say for each complex number for which the absolute value is equal to 1, we consider an operator T alpha, where the domain of the operator is given by L2 functions, which are absolutely continuous, and the derivative is in L2. I mean, there's no question about this, but the crucial thing is what are the boundary conditions. And for the boundary condition, I require that f of 1 is alpha times f of 0. Yeah, and of course, for those functions, I take again the same action of my operator. I'm just taking I times the derivative. So that as what it does on functions is always the same. That should be. But the point is really what, on which functions do we act? So T alpha of f is always I times the derivative. Yeah, and then what I just have said, I mean, it's also easy to check that all those T alphas are now actually self-adjoint extensions of my operator T. So all those T alpha, all those alphas on the unit circle, they are all self-adjoint extensions, and of course different ones. Different self-adjoint extensions of T. And on the other hand, I mean, if you do all this rigorously, you see that that's all. That's all the self-adjoint extensions, because this also corresponds to the fact that the defect index is 1. So this essentially tells us that we have one dimension. So I mean, the extensions which we have is a one-dimensional object. So it's not just one extension, but the space of extensions is essentially one-dimensional. And here we have found it's indexed by the elements on the unit circle. So this corresponds to the fact here. So if the defect indices would be 2, then essentially we would have a two-dimensional way of parametrizing the extensions. Yeah, and maybe let me finally draw maybe a kind of picture for the relation between all the things which we have, or just summarize what we really have observed here about those operators. Just a summary of everything which we have done here. So namely, we have our operator T, which I defined, and then so this is exactly this, with this domain of continuously differentiable functions and the boundary conditions, very strong boundary conditions. And then we calculated T star. So T was symmetric, but not self-adjoint, and also not essentially self-adjoint. It was not even closed. But we could close it. So if you like, I can also take here the closure, which just means I'm replacing continuously differential functions by absolutely continuous functions such that the derivative is also in L2 space. But this is just the effect of the closure. But it's not really so relevant for the relation between self-adjoint and symmetric. Yeah, so this is symmetric. And then we have the T star. And the T star is somehow an extension of this, but it's a too big extension. So this is not even symmetric anymore. Symmetric. So that's not the guy which we want. So we want something which is an extension which lives somewhere in between. And there we had this T alpha. And for each alpha, this gives us a self-adjoint extension of of t for each t on a unit circle. So for each alpha is the absolute value complex number alpha such that the complex the absolute value is equal to 1. Okay, so we get all those guys. So what I have here is I have my operator t. Here I have the operator t star. But here I have a one-dimensional curve of operators, maybe like a circle. So I'm running over the circle. For each point here on the circle, I have a t alpha. And those guys are not comparable to each other. It's not that one of them is an extension of the other, but they are all somehow on the same level, and they correspond to specifying different boundary conditions. So this means if... in order to specify my operator T or my momentum operator, it's not just enough to say the operator takes the derivative of functions, but it's really crucial that I also say what are the boundary conditions. So which functions do I consider? Of which functions do I want to consider the derivative? And actually, if I take different classes of functions, different boundary conditions, I have kind of different operators. And maybe at the moment it's not clear, not so clear what this really means, why are those guys different. But later, in particular in the context of the theorem of Stone, we will see that it's really, this is relevant information about your operator, which really makes differences. So boundary conditions are really important. Maybe in physics this is somehow clear, but we should also understand this later a bit more. So at the moment we just see this on a formal level. But at least in the context of the theorem of Stone, we will see that this really, the boundary conditions contain crucial information which we need for properties of the operator. Yeah, good. Okay, but this should be enough, I think, about this general symmetric and self-adjoint. And then next time we will move to the spectral theorem of our operator.